In this video, we're going to talk about section 9b. And 9b is all about linear functions. And linear functions are one of my favorite types of functions in math. They show up everywhere in real life. And a linear function, the root word is line. So all of these functions are going to look like straight lines when we graph them. And a linear function has the general form y equals mx plus b. In this equation, the x and y are our variables. X is the input, y is the output, and then m represents the slope. And if you think back to maybe a previous class, you learned that slope is equal to the rise over the run. Or some people think of slope as how much it goes up divided by how much it goes over. But the slope basically tells us the steepness of the line. And if the slope is positive, that means the line is going up. And if the slope is negative, the line is going down. Our b value is our y-intercept, and that tells us the value of the line where it crosses the x or the y-axis. And at the y-axis, our x value is equal to 0. So sometimes you'll hear the b value referred to as the initial value because that's where our input is 0. So often we're talking about time. So that's when time is 0. So we call that the initial value, the beginning. So we're going to look at a quick example here. I've got the equation y equals 3x minus 7, and I want to create a graph. And you can create graphs in Excel. What you have to do is have a table of values for your x's, and then I'm going to type in my function using cell references for my y's. So I'm putting in the x value and it's going to spit out the y value. And then to make the graph, I'm going to highlight both columns and then go up to Insert, Scatter, and pick the very first scatter plot. And here we have our line. And I'm going to change the layout right quick so I have places to title everything. Delete that extra data label. So here's our x values going across. Our y values are going up the side. And then this is our graph of y equals 3x minus 7. And what we can see here is that our y-intercept, where we cross the y-axis, is down here at negative 7, as it should be, because in our equation, our b-value is negative 7. So the starting value is 7 units below the origin, and this graph's kind of funny because it's got the horizontal line at negative 5 and at 0, but let's see, the x-axis would be there, where y is 0, and we see that we cross 7 units below. And what the slope of 3 means is that that's our, you can think of that as our rise over run. You could think of that as 3 divided by 1. So that's saying every 1 unit we go over, we go up 3 units. And this is probably best seen by looking at the points. When we go from negative 4 to negative 3, that's going 1 unit over. We go from negative 19 up to negative 16, so we increased by 3. When we go over to negative 2, we go up another 3, so we're up to negative 13. So every time we increase by 1 unit, because our slope is 3, that means we get bigger by 3 values. So please read the PowerPoint in this attached section in your book, the 9b in your book. They're really good sections. And if you're brand new to slope, you might want to go and get a little bit more of a closer look at that. So the point of section 9b is finding equations. And you're going to be given points, and you're expected to turn those points into a math equation that we can then use to answer and solve problems. So the book focuses on how to do it by hand, and I'm going to show you in this video how to do it in Excel. You're welcome to do it either way. I think most students find it easier and quicker to use Excel, but please know that if you want to do it by hand, you are welcome to do it by hand. It's completely correct, but you are also able to use Excel the entire time, so it's really a personal preference. So in this PowerPoint, I'm going to show you how to do the Excel procedure to get the equation of a line. First thing we've got to do is get our points, and then we're going to put them in with our first row being x values and our second row being y values. And this is probably the trickiest point. Remember that your x's have to go across the top and your y's have to go across on the bottom. If you don't have your x's as the first row and your y's as the second row, Excel's going to give you incorrect values just the way Excel thinks. And once we have our points with the x's going across the top and the y's going across the bottom, we'll then create a scatter plot, which will let us create a trend line, and that's where we'll actually get our equation of the line. So I'm going to do two examples from your lab book. Your lab book has amazing examples for this section, and a lot of them are assigned to you for attendance checks in minor labs, but I want to do number one on page 33 to get us started. So on this problem, it says, based on information in Deep River Gems Wilderness Trail Book, the rate at which crickets chirp varies linearly with temperature. At 59 degrees Fahrenheit, they make 76 chirps per minute, and at 65 degrees Fahrenheit, they make 100 chirps per minute. So first thing we need to identify are our independent and our dependent variables. So the two numbers at play here, we have information about temperature, and we have information about the number of chirps. So you've got to ask yourself, does the number of times a cricket chirps determine the weather? Or is it more likely that the weather determines the number of times the crickets chirp? And I hope you realize that in this case, you can't control, or the crickets can't control the weather, but they can respond to it. You know, none of us can control Mother Nature. So our independent variable is going to be the temperature, and our dependent variable is going to be our chirp speed. So remember, independents are our X's, dependents are our Y's. So we need our independents going across on the top and our dependents going across on the bottom. So out here beside temperature, I'm going to put in my two temperature values. We have 59 degrees and we have 65 degrees. And then below them, I'm going to put their corresponding chirp rates, which are 76 and 100. And again, it's very important to have your independents going across the top and your dependents going across the bottom. So to get our linear function, I'm going to highlight our numbers and insert a scatter plot. And then to get a trend line, what you do is you right-click on either one of the points and then go down to Add Trend Line. And then we want to select Linear and then click Display Equation on Chart. And this gets us our linear equation. Our equation is y equals negative 4x minus 160. So I'm going to write this as our chirps is equal to 4 times our temperature minus 160. I'm just putting in my variables instead of x and y so we can get it a little bit more in context. So our slope is 4. That tells us that every time our temperature goes up 1 degree, our crickets chirp 4 more times per minute. So they increase their chirp speed by 4 chirps per minute for every temperature, or for every degree we increase in temperature. And then our y-intercept of negative 160 says that when it's 0 degrees outside, our crickets are chirping negative 160 times per minute, which doesn't make sense. Honestly, if it was 0 degrees outside, these crickets would be dead. So our y-intercept doesn't really make sense in the problem. At some point, the crickets would die, and we probably won't have any alive crickets when it's 0 degrees outside. But the big thing is that for every degree we increase, our crickets chirp 4 more times per minute. So interpreting slope and y-intercept like I just did, that's really important. I can guarantee that will be on the test. Really, all of this will be, but particularly the interpretation. That's what we like to focus on in this class. So the next one says, predict the chirping rate for 70 degrees and 100 degrees. So let's see, I'm going to put 70 and 100 over here on my chart. And now we have an equation. If we put in temperature, we get out chirps. So I can type in my equation. I can do 4 times my temperature minus 160. That's the equation. And that tells us that 70 degrees, the crickets are chirping 120 times per minute. And since I used a cell reference, now all I have to do is drag it across to see that at 100 degrees, when it's really hot, the crickets are chirping 240 times per minute. That is a whole lot of chirping. And then part E says, what would you predict the temperature to be if you counted 150 chirps per minute? Now, unfortunately, we can't drag our equation over and put 150 up here because that's not chirps, that's temperature. That would be 150 degrees, and that's not what the problem's asking. And we can't just type in 150 for our chirps because that overrides the equation and it deletes everything. So instead, what we've got to do is say that really this is telling us that we have 150 chirps, and we're trying to find temperature. So I'm going to put the chirps in place of my chirp in the equation, and we're trying to find temperature. In essence, this equation is 150 equals 4 t minus 160, and we're going to have to solve this equation like you would an algebra equation. So first thing we would do is add 160 to both sides. So let's see, I'm doing mental math here, which is always a lot harder. You know, people are listening. So if I added 160 to both sides, we get 310. So we have 310 equals 4t. And then we would need to divide both sides by 4. See that t is 77.5. This is in degrees. So this is saying that if it's 77.5 degrees outside, the crickets are going to be chirping 150 times per minute. Okay. So now let's flip over to page 35 and we'll do number 1 together. And this one's a little bit different because instead of having 2 points, we're now given a bunch of points. But the process is exactly the same. So we have our years and then the amount of advertising expenses in billions of dollars. And it asks us to find a linear regression model that represents the expenses since 1980. And a regression model is basically saying come up with the best fit equation of the line. What line best models this data? The key here, though, is it says since 1980. So I'm going to create a new row in my chart that's representing our time since 1980. So if you were born in 1980 and it is 1980, no time has passed, so that's 0 years since then. 1982 would be 2 years since 1980. 1984 is 4 years, 86 is 6 years, and 88 is 8 years. The reason we're basically recentering our variable is to make our numbers smaller, to make them much easier to work with. It's a whole lot easier to work with like the number 2 than it is 1,982. So on a lot of these problems, it will say in years since a certain point, if you've got to reformat your inputs to be years since that time rather than the years themselves. And it does make it a lot easier in the long run. So to come up with our linear regression model for years and money, I'm going to highlight my smaller values. That's what we want to use. That's years since 1980. And my amount in billions of dollars. And notice I've got my years going across the top and my amount going across the bottom. We always want our input on top and our output on the bottom. And then I'm going to create a scatter plot. And then right click, add trend line. Again, linear. And I'm going to click display equation and display R squared. The R-squared tells you how well does the line fit the data. And actually, if you go back to page 33, number 1, if you display R-squared, it's going to show you 1, meaning it's a perfect fit. This one's 0.9939, meaning it's really, really good. You can tell it doesn't quite go through all the data points. But we have our linear equation up here. So our equation, let's see, what are we looking at? This is advertising expenses in billions. What we have is that's equal to 8.105 times, and then it's our years, plus 53.52. So what this means is our slope is 8.105. And let's see, this is telling us how much our ads increase per year. What did that just do? Stop. All right, so since our slope is 8.105, that tells us that for every year that passes, our ad expenses go up by $8,105,000,000. So for every year, our ad expenses go up by $8.105 billion. And then our y-intercept of 53.52, that's our initial value. That tells us that in 1980, our beginning time, according to this model, we had $53.52 in advertising expenses, which you can see isn't quite exactly what the data point was, but it's pretty close. Sometimes when you're coming up with an equation, it's not a perfect fit. We know that since our R isn't equal to 1, but it's pretty close. So now we want to do a predicted row. Again, we're saying that this equation, it looks close, but it's not exactly the same. So we want to see what does our equation predict for each one of these years. So the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to type in my equation, 8.105 times my years, and again, we're working in years since 1980, plus 53.52. And I can drag this across to see what my equation is predicting for each one of these years. And for every single case, it's really close. You know, 102.1 versus 102.15, 118.1, 118.36. So it's a really good model. It fits it really well, but it's not perfect, and that's fine. We don't expect real life to always be perfect. And then this isn't in the lab book, but just taking it further, we could use this to make predictions. Maybe it wants to know what would the advertising expenses be in 1990. Well, 1990 is 10 years from 1980. So I'm going to put my 10 years since 1980, and then all I would have to do is drag my equation over, and I could predict, according to this model, in 1990, I would have $134.57 billion in advertising expenses.